All right, guys, it's time for another round table. As usual, I'm joined by Rick Eutsler, Jim Chapman, and of course, the Godfather, Tom Gaylord. So, guys, today we are talking ammunition. All right, I know there's a lot of different sizes, shapes, all kinds of different things that I'm sure people want to know about. I know I do. So let's start, first of all, what are the different shapes of pellets?
Okay. We have four or five different shapes. We've got domed pellets or round nose pellets. We have pointed pellets. We have flat pellets that we call wad cutters. Mm-hmm. And we have
hollow points.
Hollow points. Right. And that's, there are variations on that, but those are the four main shapes.
And these are, we're talking, this is the basic, the 177 to maybe 22 caliber pellets.
25 as well.
Okay.
They come in the same mixture of heads.
There are really four calibers, 177, 20, 22, and 25.
Okay.
So those are your four small bore calibers.
All right. Yeah. So tell me, what is each one good for, and what are the differences, especially if you're talking hunting?
Well, you know, it's a funny thing. The pellet that was designed to be a hunting pellet are called pointed or field tips. I don't use them that often because in most guns, they're not the most accurate pellet. Mm-hmm. But they do give penetration. And if you happen to have a gun that fires them well, and this is something we can talk about, different guns like different pellets. But if it fires them well, they can be effective. Probably the typical pellet used by most airgun hunters is a round nose or a dome pellet. And the reason is that they have good terminal performance. They penetrate well. They offload a lot of energy on the animal that you're hunting. And they're accurate. Importantly, they're accurate out of most guns. So I think most hunters would use a dome pellet. Some might go to a flat pellet or a wad cutter, or for that matter, a hollow point, if they've got a very powerful gun and they want to reduce the penetration, if they're shooting around outbuildings, barns, around equipment, livestock. And those are far less likely to over-penetrate. You dump all the energy right on target. But I'd say by far and away the dome pellet is the preferred pellet for hunters.
Okay, let's go over to our critic. What do you think? What do you see as the best pellet for the average hunter?
Well, generally speaking, what you want is the most accurate pellet. Mm-hmm. I don't care if it's pointed. I don't care if it's got a red flaming thing coming out the backside. Doesn't matter.
Haven't seen that one yet, but
haven't seen.
Fun.
You never know.
It sounds really fun, right?
You never know what they're going to come out with next.
It's in R&D.
Yeah,
coming down the thing.
But the point is that you want to find the most accurate pellet. And for some guns, you know, that's going to vary wildly. You find that most accurate pellet, and you just stick with it.
And what do you find to be the most accurate pellet that you've come across?
You want a quality pellet. You want something that's manufactured consistently from 10 to 10 to 10 to 10. And I find a couple brands that way. RWS is a good one. H&N's a good one. JSB is probably the most consistently accurate in the widest range of guns that I test.
Any particular shape?
Always the dome pellet.
Always the dome.
Yeah.
Okay. Tom,
dome,
you too?
Dome here with one exception. The wad cutter over there. In target shooting, you have to use a wad cutter pellet. It's specified in the rules because they want you to cut a perfectly round hole in the target. When you manually score a target, you need that round hole to key the scoring instrument on. So you can't use a jagged hole that might be cut by a dome or any other shape.
Mm-hmm.
But other than that, I would always shoot a dome pellet.
Okay, so this is the one you're talking about. So when it comes to target or competitions, there is a specific pellet everyone has to use, yeah?
Yeah.
Is it the same? Is
not only specific,
the tip and the skirt all the same?
Not only specific in shape, but also in caliber. You can only shoot target with 177 caliber pellets.
Okay.
Let me throw out one proviso, though. We're talking about 10-meter match and informal competition.
Yes, but we are.
There are other competitions. There's bench rest. People are shooting out longer ranges. And then you start to see dome is the most frequently used.
That's true.
Silhouette with dome as well. So.
What about like Olympic shooting? Is that?
That's your 10-meter match.
Okay.
10 meters is, 33 feet. So that's how far they are from the target.
Okay.
And these guys shoot at a target the size of the eraser on the end of your pencil. And if they miss it more than once in an entire 60-shot match, they're out.
The same hole, basically, in 60 shots.
Yeah.
So those guys, they're really good.
Yeah, they're really,
really
good.
Really good.
Really,
like,
really good.
Ridiculously good.
Right. But there's an example of what the function is going to be. Those same pellets at 10 meters are very accurate. Go out to 25 or 30 with them, and they're
terrible.
They're terrible.
Yeah,
ballistic coefficient is bad, and they start to, you get a shotgun scatter.
Yeah.
Interesting. So what is it about the different shapes with the distances that makes one better than the other?
Aerodynamics. And that gets us into another part of a pellet, and that is its shape besides just the nose. Mm-hmm. The pellet has a shape that's called Diabolo. It means it has a pinched or wasp waist, a flared tail that is almost always hollow on the inside. And that pinched waist and that flared tail both create high drag. So when you shoot the pellet, it is slowing down, basically, like something's pulling on it. That keeps the pellet pointed in the direction it's headed, and it also makes the pellet not go as far as a bullet would.
Right.
Okay.
And so that's a big part of the safety. We were talking about hunting in areas you couldn't use a .22 rimfire. Well, part of the reason, even though the velocity may start out almost the same as a rimfire, at distance, it sloughs off that velocity so rapidly because of the ballistic, the less good ballistic coefficient, that they won't travel as far.
Okay, so that's obviously the situation with the pellets. What about when we move into the bigger rifles with some of the bigger caliber bullets? Talk to me about those a little bit.
All bets are off. When you get into what we call a conical bullet, like this.
Okay.
The conical bullet.
Conical because it's shaped like a cone, I'm guessing?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Right. And they have the same ballistics as they would if they were shot in a firearm. Mm-hmm. The only difference is they're not going as fast out the muzzle when they're shot from an air gun.
Right. So, but I'm looking here. Obviously, there's a few different shapes here. I mean, some are, like you said, a cone, a little bit more what you a normal bullet. Some look like I don't even know what, like a red paper cup.
All right. That right there is a shape that is more conducive to making the bullet or pellet than it is to shooting it.
Okay.
It happened to work out that the swage was easy to machine. The thing that squeezed the lead down was easy to machine. Your bullet shape, that's your more efficient projectile over long range. And then you have something like this, I don't know, that's a hollow point. It's also a sort of a pointed bullet. It's not a very long range bullet, but it's very effective at close range, especially on game animals.
Yeah, there's actually a bit of a debate going on with any of these, whether the hollow points make sense in the big bore, because you're not shooting at very high velocity, so you don't get the expansion that you would out of a firearm and the hydrostatic shock delivered to the animal. On the other hand, what my experience has been that the hollow points, especially the large hollow points, they cut a very clean hole through the game. So they give a cleaner wound channel, larger wound channel, that doesn't close back up. So I think the hollow point has some legs in big game hunting.
What do you, I mean, obviously does the size, this is much taller than this one, does that affect the distance?
Absolutely. Imagine a guy throws a softball and the same guy throws a spear. Okay, the spear, when it hits, it's going to do more than the softball is. Mm-hmm. The softball is large, it's going to slow down faster, and it's also going to spread its energy out when it hits. The spear is just going to keep on going. This is a spear. This is a softball.
And what's the caliber of that, the softball?
That one, I'm going to say that's a 45. My eyeball says it's either 45
Like 45.
Yeah, okay. And this is for sure a 45.
But what do we have here? This is a 30?
That's a 30, 308.
Right.
That's a 9mm. I think that's also a 9mm.
Okay, same here?
I think so, yes. Three.
This is a 22?
That's a 25.
25,
yes.
These are 22s?
That's a 25 and that's a 22. That's an actual 25 caliber pellet, I believe.
Okay, so you can get, so now can you shoot the same gun, this and this?
Well, you can, but boy,
whether or not that's going to work, we don't know.
It's going to go really fast.
Actually, what's going to happen, if you shoot the pellet, it's going to be inaccurate.
Yeah.
You're going to blow out the skirt on it. It's going to be inaccurate.
Because the air that it takes to shoot this heavier projectile is way too much.
Heavier ones are for PCP guns specific?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Got it. And then the pellet guns are for the spring rifle.
Or either. It could
or
be
CO2
or PCP. Yeah, it can be used for any of them.
But, okay, so you can move the pellet to a PCP, but you can't necessarily move the PCP bullets down to a CO2.
That's right.
Yeah, and I was just going to say that. You know, if you put that pellet in a high-powered PCP rifle, you make it fragments coming out the end. But if you took that bullet and wedged it into a 25-cal spring gun, you may not get anything out the end.
There, right?
You actually can damage your gun. You'll blow the seal out. You'll do all manner of nastiness to your weapon if you do that.
Again, it depends on application because bullets that you see that are used out of mid-bore and big-bore guns, that's to get the most penetration, to get the most distance out of the shot. But there are times with a given gun, you might not want that. For instance, if you're shooting coyotes in a suburban area, you don't want the travel of the pellet. And they're using a traditional style pellet, as we were looking at in these standard 22-25 caliber pellets, out of a 303 or 308 or 357, gives you the advantage of opening a big wound channel. But if you miss, It's not going to travel as far. Even if you hit, it's not going to over-penetrate. So again, you have to look for the most accurate pellet out of a gun, as Rick was saying. But also, you have to think about what you're using it for. And you may shift the pellet you use in any given gun based on that.
Are all pellets made of the same material?
Not at all.
Okay. What are they typically made of?
Most of these are made of lead, right. And that's the traditional material. Mm-hmm. It's malleable. It's easy to form. It's heavy, so it's dense, and that gives it good energy retention over flight. But these days, lead is not necessarily friendly to the environment. A lot of places don't like lead, especially when it accumulates, like sure. at a backstop. So some localities have mandated lead-free pellets, and we have some here. They look exactly like lead pellets,
right.
but they have no lead in them. They're made out of another metal. It works in the guns that we shoot them in, and they meet the letter of the law.
Does it affect the shots, in your experience?
Yeah.
It does.
There are some lead-free pellets. There's some very popular ones out there that are advertised that just don't do well. Mm-hmm. There are some that do well. Again, it comes down to the gun. You got to test it. We have a sampler pack here, which I think is really important to talk about. When I get a new gun and I'm going to do a review, you know, I have maybe 20 or 30 pellets that I will run that gun through. I'm sure, Tom, you have the same
sure.
process. And you're going to find some that are better than others, and then you start wheeling those down. Yeah. Well, you know, I have that as a resource, but you're a new air gunner. You buy this gun. You just spent a couple $100. And now you're looking at, well, how do I get it to shoot right? Well, goodness, I got to spend another $75 in pellets, and all but one is not going to work.
Right.
You know, here you can spend maybe $15 or $20, and more than likely, one of those pellets is going to do exactly what you want, going to give you what you need, and then you can go and buy that pellet.
Is there that big of a difference in, like, if I've got five rifles, are they all going to shoot the same pellet differently?
And that's actually very interesting, because you can have five guns that are all from the same model,
yep.
and they won't necessarily shoot yeah. the same pellet the best. You still have to look at each of those guns and see which pellet works the best. And I don't know the reason. You're going to ask that, but I don't know the reason.
How do you figure that out? And what is it that affects the pellet in a certain gun? Like, aren't basically the guns pretty much built the same on the inside of the yeah. barrel?
In terms of what you do, Rick was mentioning it, you try all the pellets that you can. You know, I think everybody, and I'm sure both you guys, have like four or five pellets that work well more consistently than others.
Sure.
And that's always in the bunch that you start with. But you start grabbing other pellets. And so I look again at what I'm going to do. Am I going to be using them for long-range shooting? Mm-hmm. Am I going to be in short-range shooting? But then I'll try several different pellets and see what works best out of the gun.
Right. Does it change as the gun gets older? Like, will all of a sudden one pellet just work better?
It changes, but not as the gun gets older, because the guns don't really wear. Mm-hmm. They can shoot for millions. I mean millions of shots.
Okay.
But if the gun gets dirty, it changes like right now.
But that would affect any pellet. That wouldn't.
That's
that would,
right. That's okay. right. And sure. when your best pellet starts giving you big groups, it's time to clean the barrel.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's the only time you really do clean the barrel on guns, at least in my opinion.
One thing I was just going to mention, we were talking earlier about the materials that pellets are made out of. Mm-hmm. One of the other things that you see with the alloy pellets is that they tend to be a lot lighter and they go at higher velocities. And a lot of companies out there are pushing that my gun does the highest velocity, right. it's higher velocity than others. At least in my application, it's not about the velocity. It's about getting the accuracy and what the terminal performance is. And one thing I've noticed with the lighter alloy pellets is that they shed velocity more rapidly.
Yeah,
so even if they're accurate at 25 yards, 30 yards, by the time I get to 40 or 50, they start to open up again.
Yeah.
So I know I'm jumping back. We were talking about the impact of the material, and I think that's a significant one for me.
That is.
When you talk about these guns, the differences in, let's talk about like a break barrel, you put one pellet in, you shoot it, put another pellet in, shoot it, versus like the little magazines that come in a lot, some of the pistols, and now we're seeing in some of the rifles where you mm-hmm. can put 8 or 10 or 12 or whatever in.
Right.
Do you see a difference in if you're shooting more rapidly versus just loading a single at a time?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
In fact, with that type of magazine, the circular clip,
yeah.
you really shouldn't use pointed pellets because they're just a little bit longer than they should be, and like as not, they'll tie up the gun. They'll jam the gun. So,
and you guys don't really like the pointed pellets anyway, right?
If they're
the most accurate, I love them.
Yeah.
But if they're not accurate, I don't care for them.
Okay.
If you look at some of the polymer tipped ones, for instance, I don't know the reason, but I have better results in terms of the accuracy with some of those, the Predator International type of pellets.
Let's look at the base material, though. That's a JSP pellet.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, you're looking at something that's hand sorted, generally speaking. Yeah. I mean, it's a higher price point. Well,
and they're also stored. That's something we didn't talk about, but the way the pellets are stored when they come to you, you have to make sure they're protected. You know, sometimes you buy in bulk, you get a box of pellets, and the weight of the pellets and the way they're hit will start to damage the skirts.
And we know how well things are shipped. Yeah. We know how much they care for our products as they move from weigh station to weigh station.
So you're saying in a situation like this, they'll damage each other.
Yeah, they can. If they had a lot of pressure on the tin, that could dent the skirts on any of those. So you may have most of the tin shooting perfectly, and all of a sudden you start throwing off flyers when you shoot. And I always look at the skirt when that starts to happen. Right. And very often I find dented ones.
So before you load your gun, you need to look and make sure that it's at least in the way it was created to look, right?
You should, yeah.
Because if the skirt's dented, you're talking about, we're not talking millimeters here, we're talking feet.
Oh, yeah.
And okay. I'm not that disciplined. I look to make sure the tin doesn't have any dents.
And that's about it.
It's like, would you put a crooked bullet in your gun?
Yeah.
No.
Right. So, but again, you got to pay attention because they're little and some people you just grab and put them. Yeah. Now, for the lazy hunter like myself, or, you know, if it's cold and you're wearing gloves, or if you just have, I mean, some people just have big fat fingers, is there an easier way than grabbing one pellet at a time and sticking it in?
Oh, yeah. We got some samples here on the table. This one is in 177, and you can. You see here, if I'm going to push up here, you've got pellets in there.
Okay.
So you can actually line that up with the breech of the gun, pop your pellet in. You can keep this in your pocket. Well, somebody.
Right.
You can keep this in your pocket like that. And so when you're in the field, you're not fumbling around your pockets or whatever to get your pellet out. So we take this out, pop it in your rifle, and you're good to go.
I just want to test this guy. Now, I feel like you already don't like this.
No, I was going to say it's a great thing because one of the problems I've had using my Springer is I see a squirrel running up in the tree and I want to take the shot and my fingers are numb like you were mentioning and I'm dropping one pellet. There's nothing so frustrating as seeing your game hopping around and going away and you're fumbling pellets.
Just up there laughing at you.
I'm seeing another one of her, but it's got a point on it.
That little guy there is a pellet seeder.
Okay.
So you've loaded your pellet into the barrel. This allows you to push it into the rifling deeper, and you can adjust this to the depth you want. Some low-powered spring guns really like to have deep-seated pellets. Others hate it, so you have to find out again.
It's a trial and error.
Yeah, it's trial and error.
We should all be happy these guys exist so we can figure out where to put our bullet, what kind of pellet, what the skirt looks like. Goodness gracious.
The other really cool point about that is that some guns, the breech may not be beveled as much as it should. So you'll insert a pellet, you'll have a skirt half sticking out. When you go to shut that gun, it cuts the skirt off.
Yep.
So when you have that kind of a tool in your arsenal, you know that you can always seat it exactly the same way. That's going to improve accuracy. And you actually use the pellets properly because it's very easy. You just shut the gun and don't realize you cut half your pellet off.
Mm. What other good accessories are out there for ammunition and such?
Well, I never like to waste money. And I'll tell you, the worst thing you can do as an air gunner is have an open tin of pellets in a big box and spill it.
I can imagine.
Worse than that is to spill two tins, because then you don't know what you have. This guy holds onto your tin and yet doesn't let him pop open, which is very handy. But that has to fit on a tin of a certain size, as you can see. This guy, which I used to use as just plain old rubber bands, but now we have the Pyramyd Air name on it.
Of course. I mean, why not?
Just goes
mass
over
market
like
it.
That, and there you go. Yeah. And that'll fit on your big tin as easily as it'll fit on this.
So then you just throw that in your pocket, or if something like this you're saying you can just wear on your belt, and you've got it if you need it.
Right? Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, one of the things I like about these is that you can label them, because I have got so many boxes and bottles and pill jars full of pellets, I have no idea what they are.
Right.
Which, you know, it's fine if I find they shoot well out of a particular gun, but I can't really use them if I want to look at performance, because, I mean, what am I comparing to?
Right.
And every air gunner I know has a box somewhere just half filled with a mixture of pellets.
Mm-hmm. Sure. All right, well, let's just talk, guys. We're almost out of time, but I just want to, if someone out there has just gone out and bought their first pellet gun, maybe they've just got a nice, you know, good brake barrel of some sort, what's the best way for them to go about finding the right ammunition for the gun that they own?
I can take this if that's right with you guys.
Yeah.
Get some sample packs. Yep. I mean, Pyramyd Air sells RWS, JSB, and H&N sample packs. If you spend a little money on that, you're going to walk away with about 20 different pellets. And one of those pellets is going to shoot pretty darn good in your gun, more than likely.
One other thing. A pellet gun is not a BB gun.
Yes.
And the new person often mixes them up. The BB is made of steel. Mm-hmm. It's made for a smooth bore or a specially rifled barrel. The pellet gun has a regularly rifled barrel. It'll handle a lead pellet. It will not like BBs. They'll fall through. They'll wreck the bore.
So, A, don't be an idiot. Know what you're buying. And B, make sure you buy the right kind of ammunition for the gun that you bought, right?
And put the time in.
Sure.
Yeah. Be ready to put the time in. And that's part of the fun of the sport. It's what I really enjoy that part of it, is finding it. You know, you start off with groups like this, and you wind up with groups like that. Because you put the time in. That's a lot of fun.
Well, see, and for me, I personally, no matter where I'm shooting or when I'm shooting, I always blame the bullet. Guys, that's all the time we got for this round table. I appreciate you guys, as always. Great information. If you guys want to know more about the pellets and the bullets that we're talking about, go to AmericanAirGunner.com. You can find information there. And, of course, all these guys' websites and information is there, too. So, appreciate it. Now, let's find out what's best for Rossi. I think it's going to be a shotgun.